Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, Falmouth Congregational Church, what can I tell you about the suffering that we have been through this year? The deaths, the terror, the tedium, the feeling of swimming in time like it is an endless, amorphous, gray fog. What can I say on this Sunday, a year and a day after the first time we couldn't meet in person? A year since many of us have hugged our grandchildren or our siblings, seen our family, gone to a movie, had a date. A year in which more than 500,000 people, including people in this church, died. The deadliest year in American history. I stand here this morning, and I am grieving, and I am exhausted, and quite frankly, I don't have any personal wisdom to share. And in times like this, in moments just like this one, it is when it is a special blessing to be a Christian. Because I don't have to tell you about my own wisdom. I don't have to make anything up or invent something or create something new. Because we have been given this treasure of thought, this treasure of thought from people who have lived through pestilence and isolation and fire and flood, people who saw devastation and illness and death aplenty. So this morning, although I don't have any wisdom for you, I'm going to lean on the ancient wisdom of Scripture, on our Bible, which has wisdom to share. Christianity teaches that the earth's separation from God, that separation that allows us to exist, to have freedom, to move and be, this gift creates places in the world where the world can be distracted from the presence of God by lesser things. That in our search for God, we can find on the way other things instead. We can be searching, for example, for security. And instead of finding God, who is the only real source of security, we can, say, begin to pile up money or possessions or diplomas. We can be searching for love, and instead of turning to God, the source of all love, we can end up turning to superficial relationships. In the space created by our freedom, space without which we would not exist, we can settle. We can settle on something that is not worthy of us. And we can do this without ever having known that we were searching for God at all. And this distraction, this settling, the scriptures tell us, distorts the world. And this is why we can proclaim that death has been defeated while standing at a funeral. Because we believe in the Christian tradition that death and evil and all the things that cause pain and inhibit life and goodness are a type of fool's gold, a sort of mirage in which we walk. They are empty, a symptom of empty space. And the feelings that they leave in us, those feelings of emptiness, are created because they are just that, empty space. And so this morning, a year and a day into this pandemic, if you are exhausted by COVID, if you are angry at violence, if you are sick with grief over the death of one you loved, if these things make you rage or cry or sleep, if you hate these parts of the world with all of your being, good. Good. Because these things are not part of God's plan. These things do not come from God. The God we worship does not mandate, ordain, condone, bless, or create suffering. But God does not leave us alone in suffering either. God joins us fully in our pain. God closes the gap by going to every place where suffering or illness or death are. Jesus, fully human and fully divine, submits to suffering, submits even to death, so that we might never be alone. So that there is no place that we might ever go where God has not been. No place that we can find ourselves where God does not follow. While we turn away from God, God never turns away from us. And not only does God never leave us alone in our suffering, but God uses it. At every moment, God is calling us and the world towards goodness and wholeness and life. Our God, that one who came and used the very cross to teach us about freedom and love, can absolutely use everything, everything that has happened this year. From the ashes of our grief and exhaustion and rage and our suffering, God can call forth new, abundant, eternal life, life in which we and the whole world can participate. God not only can do that, but God will. And that is good news. It is good news for today. It is good news for tomorrow. It is good news for forever, for all times. Praise be to God, and amen.